Right now you're listening to me through the Lewitt Ray microphone on the Lewitt Connect 2, because my goal is to connect you to the Connect 2, and that will be too cool. Anyway, this is a very cool little audio interface. It's been on my desk for a couple months now, and I really like it, and I want to tell you all about it. But first, look at this very necessary camera angle. I do want to let you know that Lewitt did send the Connect 2 to me for free. They connected it me to it for free. I don't have to make a video. I don't have to say anything. I have a whole ethics statement video all about how that stuff happens. They just let me know what something they were coming out with if I wanted to check it out. And I said yes, because even as someone who does prefer bigger mixers, like here's my Rodecaster Duo. I've got my Rodecaster Pro 2, the Mackie DLZs. I love me a mixer where I can plug in multiple inputs. I have physical faders, physical channels. I can do onboard internal recording, internal effects processing. I don't even need a computer. That's kind of the joy of those things to me, is that I don't even need a computer in order for them to work. But I recognize that's not for everyone. Those do tend to be more expensive. They do tend to be more complex. Even the smaller Rodecaster Duo takes up a bit more space. Look how virtually no space this thing takes up. When I first saw the form factor of this, I did not like it. I thought it was weird. There's no physical buttons. It's just sort of this strange little, like, it looks like a trackpad. Using it, I love using this thing. It has been my main interface here, I guess, for about 2 months now. I have the Rodecaster's kind of been neglected a little bit because I've been using this for everything so that I could get to know it before making a video about it. And overall, I love it. There are a couple of things, primarily software related, that we'll be talking about. The interface itself is quite fantastic, and I think that its closest competitor would be something like this, the Focusrite Scarlett Solo. This is the third gen. But now there's a fourth gen, and that would be most comparable. The difference being price. The Focusrite 4th Gen has an MSRP of $119, whereas the Connect 2 has an MSRP of $199. Now, the Connect 2 does have 72 decibels of clean gain, which is more than enough for pretty much any mic you're going to use it with. I'm using it with a condenser microphone right now, so this doesn't need a lot of gain, but it does have enough to run other microphones, which I'll show you in a second when we show how to set this up. And it does, the reason it's called the Connect 2, which threw me off because there's only one XLR input, and I was like, but I can only connect one thing to the Connect 2. The reason they call it that is because there's also a quarter inch instrument input. So you've got one XLR, one quarter inch, and that means you could connect a mic and an instrument, two things. I got a little confused by that at first. And one thing I do like, so talking about the design, the Focusrite Scarlett Solo and the Scarlett series in general, you kind of notice they do have stuff on the back, like a USB and your monitor output, but pretty much all your input's on the front. And so if that's sitting on your desk like this, what that means is you have all your cables kind of going at the front, running out the back. Something I've really liked about the Connect 2 is that everything comes out the back of it. So right now you can kind of see on here, I have my XLR mic connected. There is an instrument input there, but I don't have anything connected in that. 48 volt phantom power button, which I do have turned on for the mic I'm using right now. And I have two quarter inch stereo outputs for my speaker, because this has been my primary in-out audio interface. And so I've been listening to, everything I've listened to on my speaker in here has been through this since I've gotten it. And then you also have headphone output. So I have my quarter inch connected here, but there's also a 3.5. So no matter what kind of headphones you have, which size headphones you have, you can use those there. And then also the USB-C connector right there, which I have found. I don't think it likes running through a hub at all. Like, I had it running through my Mac Mini's hub right here, and the software would sort of say, no device connected, yes device connected, no device, yes device. And the best advice I can give is to just not connect it through a hub, but to run it directly into your computer. Once I switch that, it's been significantly more reliable. Again, you don't have to use the software. I'm someone who kind of hates dedicated software apps. So as soon as you connect the Connect 2 to your computer, it will show up as an in-out source in whatever, you know, streaming software, video conferencing software, audio, whatever. But in this case, I do think the software is worth it because it does give you some more features and allows you to do some pretty cool customization. So if you're not a software person, if you're somebody who hates working with software applications, this is not for you. If you're someone who doesn't mind it or even enjoys it, then you could potentially love this. But hopefully you can kind of see right here with all of those outputs running out the back, I guess except the headphone one, it keeps everything very nice and clean and organized. And as someone who just recently redid my studio and my desk setup, keeping things simple and clean and organized is pretty cool. So before I jump in and start talking about the software, I do want to talk about different microphones. I have been using the Lewitt Ray, which is great because it's got that thing where it's going to adjust the gain automatically for me as I'm moving around, which is nice as I'm switching through these very unnecessary camera angles. But let's switch over to a different microphone, a more gain-hungry, probably the toughest microphone for an interface to run, the Shure SM7B. This also answers another common question I get of, can you mount the SM7B to the Elgato low profile arm? Yes, you can. As you can see right here, sometimes you can use those little mic extension tubes if you want a little more boost to give more clearance for your XLR cable. The thing I want to show you right now is how to adjust the gain for your microphone. If I go over to the Connect 2, there are the microphone and instrument buttons right here. I don't have an instrument output, so there's nothing there. The microphone one, you can kind of see that there, and I can just slide this to turn my gain up or down. I realize you can't hear me, but I press the mute switch to mute the audio. I can unmute that there. I can also adjust my monitor output and my headphone monitoring as well. It's a couple other things we'll talk about in a second, but check this out. This is pretty cool. This middle button here, if I press that, it's then going to ask me to choose the microphone or the instrument. I'm going to do the microphone, and then I'm going to press this button again, and now I'm just going to keep talking, and this is measuring my gain level as I'm talking, and it's hearing how loud I'm talking, and then once it's all finished, it's going to automatically adjust the gain. And there we go. It set the gain to 52 decibels on the SM7B. So 52 out of 72. So to me, that actually works really well at getting your mic adjusted and sounding good. And as you can hear, this is the SM7B. I'm recording into Adobe Audition with no effects and no processing, but I can go through the Lewitt Control Center app right here. You can kind of see everything I've got. This is my microphone input, nothing on the instrument. And then you've got built-in loopback if you want to incorporate your computer's audio as the sounds as a sound source here. You've got your monitor outputs and your headphone outputs, and then this is a mix, how much I want to hear of just my headphone, or do I want to just hear the computer, in which case I actually can't hear anything in my headphone right now, or do I want a mix of both? So if you're doing like a video call, putting this in the middle is good, so you hear the person on the call and you kind of hear yourself. If you don't need to hear your computer at all, or you only want to hear your computer, you can adjust that right there. And you can also monitor your instrument or your microphone. And then right here we have, you know, I can adjust the gain same way I could physically on the Connect 2. I could add a low pass filter. So right now I don't have any low pass filter turned on, but if I click that button, now I've turned on a low pass filter on the SM7B, which I feel like does not make this mic sound better. But if you're in a rumbly environment, if you have a really deep voice, if you have a really boomy mic, turning that on could help. In this case, turning off the low pass filter, I like the way the SM7B sounds that way better. Now there are a couple other things here. There's a clean, a warm, and a vivid. Those are just sort of basic tones if you want to add those. You don't have to, but if you want to, you can choose a sound for your preamp. This is the clean tone. Right now you're listening to me on the warm tone. It's getting to be summer where I'm at right now. It's getting warm over here. And this is vivid. This is that real broadcast, crispy, like, you know, top of the hour, every hour, news, weather, traffic, that kind of traditional broadcast sound. Sounds great on the SM7B, to be honest. There are no specific mic presets like there are on something like the Rodecaster. You just have that clean, warm, and vivid preset. But depending on your microphone, that should cover a lot of your bases. I'm going to go back to clean just because I like the way that sounds. You do have the option to use a denoiser, which works pretty cool. So if I go over here and I click on denoise, what it's going to do is it's going to ask me to shut up for a second and just listen to the environment. And now it listened to the background and it's applying a noise filter to sort of get the cleanest audio possible. I can also add a compressor. I'm under pressure to add the compressor. I can add some compression to my audio here, which again, a compressor is something that reduces your highs and then also boosts your lows and then makes your signal a lot more compressed, but also a lot more stable. So especially with things like spoken word, that can prevent people from having to constantly turn the volume up and down a lot while they're listening. So you can add all that stuff there. I can do the denoise, the compressor, the vivid, and now we've got this very processed sound. I'm actually going to go back to just the simple clean sound because that's the one that I like. Now there is something up here. There is ClipGuard. What that does is it prevents your input from distorting. It's not 32-bit float audio, but it's one of those things where if you do have a lot of dynamic range, like right there I said, but, and it was a little bit louder than the but was bigger than the rest of the sentence, it kind of helps protect your audio in those situations. Now this app, like I mentioned, is absolutely important. So if I go over here, there's more than just this that I can do in here. You can easily change your sample rate, which I love. I'm recording this audio for video, so I have a 48,000 kilohertz sample rate selected because that's gonna make syncing and keeping the audio synced for video as easy as possible. Easier than that sentence anyway. But if I go into my settings, there are a few other options here. I have the current most updated firmware version, but I could update that here. You sort of got some little options here. But if we go into audio, we have a few options. So we have things like gain lock, which I do have turned on. I have everything else essentially turned off. But depending on your headphones, I'm not using high impedance headphones, but if you are, if you're a fancier boy than I am, you can click that button and your headphones might work a little bit better there. You can also go down here and customize your LEDs. So right now what you're seeing is just how it comes out of the box. Everything is just sort of these colors, which are very easy to understand. But right now, you know, if I wanted my metering to not be white and I wanted it to be, say, a color like blue, I can just select that right here and now I can customize that. This has no effect on your audio quality, just like something like this does, but it's fun. Sometimes you might just want to, maybe you see different colors and it's helpful if you have specific colors because your eyes like see those colors better. Sometimes it's just for fun or for branding, as the marketing professionals say. What I like is, if you can kind of see here, I can change this and it changes in real time. So sometimes when you do stuff like this, you have to select the color you want and then click finish before you see what it looks like. This, you can just click and drag in real time to find the color you want. So I do have that mute switch at the top. I have my monitor volume there, which I can do that to adjust my monitors. I can do this to adjust my headphones. This button down here is that input versus computer mix. So right now it's all my headphones. This would be all USB. This would be a mix in between. I'm gonna go back to all headphones just because it's nice. Everything you can adjust in the software, you can also adjust via the hardware. But you also do have this custom button right here. So if I go back to the software and I click on the gear, I can go to custom button, and that's this button right here. I can choose what I want it to do. Right now I have mine set to do control center, which is the default and what I have found to be most useful. But you can also change your preamp style. So if I want to go for those clean, vivid, warm tones, I can jump through there. Same with instruments. You can also do some cool stuff about muting your headphones, unmuting speakers. I mean, it tells you what you do. I don't need to tell you there. But you do have different options for that one custom button. I like the control center because what it lets me do is, when I just have this plugged as an interface and I'm using it, and I don't need the software, but suddenly I need it, instead of having to like find it on my computer and open it, I can just push that button and then boom, the software opens up. Now, I did talk about some potential software bugs, and this is one of those things where the software works pretty well most of the time. Again, as long as you're not running it through a hub, at least in my experience on the M1 Mac Mini, it did not like being run through a hub, but if you just connect it directly, then it's fine. Hopefully things can be stabilized in future firmware. The biggest issue I've had here with the software is just being able to monitor my audio. It is so frustrating because sometimes it just does not. I plug in my headphones and I have everything adjusted and it just won't actually display an output even though I know it's correct. And so then sometimes I just sort of unplug it, plug it back in, and then it sends the output signal for my monitor. That has been a hard thing. Even though I know, I can see in my software I'm getting a signal, I can see it on here that there's a signal, it's just not actually sending a signal out to the headphones, even though everything says that it is, including the headphone monitor right here bouncing up and down showing that. Even though this is put all the way over to do headphone directly, I'm just not getting headphone output. That's a random thing. Sometimes it's a problem, sometimes it's not a problem. It's been a problem less when the interface is connected directly to the computer and not running through a hub. But it's just one of those things where every time I open it, I'm kind of like, is it gonna work this time or is it not gonna work this time? And those are things that are never that fun to deal with. But overall, I do think it's a pretty great interface for anybody who does not need the capabilities of a Rodecaster. You don't need individual channels and tons of different inputs and onboard recording and processing and all that. But if you are someone who's looking for a simple way to get XLR or instrument audio gear into your computer, then the Connect 2 is something that might be worth connecting to. And speaking of connecting, I want to connect my gratitude to everyone who helps support my channel through Patreon and YouTube channel memberships. And if you want to know a little bit more about podcasting and audio and streaming audio gear, check out these videos right here.